And any other co-hosts just hit okay, things like that. And then let's go live on Facebook.
You're getting good at this, Rochelle.
2 million. She's done it a few times. And now it's very quiet.
I think she's still getting into Facebook.
Right for Facebook. It's working. Becky, what if you don't remember when you paid your dues? I can
All
look for
right.
you.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Welcome to Upper Midwest Bead Society. Let's bead live. I'm Rochelle J, and I'm so excited for all of you to join us today. We have so much fun stuff going on with our events this month. And today with us, we have Meredith Roddy from Beadalon. We're so excited. She's doing a right angle weave, two needle version, etc. So if you have not got the supplies yet, go quickly to our umbs.org website and you can download and look at all the supply lists and gather everything up. And it's really fun and easy. And so if you're watching us on Facebook, we are just so darn excited to have you. If you want to join us through Zoom, the Zoom link is also there. So you could join us through Zoom through this whole event. We're here from 1 to 3 o'clock, and we love to have you on either platform. And so I want to introduce to you our president, Jan Carlson. Let's spotlight for everyone. She's got a couple announcements.
I have one announcement. The spring retreat is coming up towards the end of March, March 20th through the 24th. We welcome anyone to join us there. It's at Camp Wapagoset near Amory, Wisconsin. You can come for one day or multiple days. There are bunk beds there, and we recommend that you bring something soft to sleep on because the mattresses are kind of hard. But all of the information for that will be on our umbs.org website, and we will have some teachers there that will be featured. We hope to get a teacher for each day, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Wednesday is kind of a half day, and Sunday we have brunch the morning and then pretty much pack up after that. So, and it's a fun thing. So just even come for one day to join us. And that's Rochelle, that's all I've got.
All right, super. And then we have our member spotlight. Becky, gonna talk to you about your membership.
Okay, it used to be that everyone's membership was due the end of December, and a couple of years ago we changed that. But the majority of people are still due the end of December, and if you haven't paid your membership, we would appreciate it if you did that. You can pay through PayPal, and if you don't have PayPal, email me and I can send you an invoice, and you can pay with any credit card. Thank
And
you.
how much is the membership if you're not a member, Becky?
It's $35 a year, and it gets
Okay.
you links to all of our meetings and all of our stuff.
Super. So go to umbs.org and hit the membership page. Pay your bills. And I will do that too. I just got paid, so I will send you a check. So that's also a possibility. You can do that if you're the old-fashioned type like me.
Yep.
And so we have many other ones.
Actually, the checks go to the treasurer, Nanita Nordan.
The treasurer go to Nanita. Okay, so then
Checks,
we'll
yes.
get
And
Nanita's
Shelley,
address.
I don't see your name as paid. I will look further and I will email you after the meeting.
Okay, thanks. I'm sure I'm not paid for the
Okay.
next year. I'm just not sure when I owe.
Okay. So then talk to Becky about when you owe, when your membership is due. If you do pay through PayPal, just one of those things, PayPal will remind you 1 year later. So it's a really quick and easy way to do it if you want to do it that way. We have many different events, though, that are free to everyone, like today, our Let's Bead Live. And our February Let's Bead Live actually comes before our meeting, but our membership covers our Monday night meetings. And so our Monday meeting for February, because of the Tucson show, and so many of our people are going to be down there, especially our speaker for February, which is Betty Cox. We're so excited. I don't know if you've seen her on the internet in the Battle of the Beadsmith. She made a really groovy guitar. And but everything Betty does is all about bright colors, happy, joy. And so we thought in the middle of February, it would be a really good just spot of brightness and colorful joy to have her come speak to us all about her colorful inspirations and how she comes up with these amazing, just really vivid projects that are just so happy to look at as well. I can't believe to wear. And so that is Monday, February 12th. But if you want to see her in person, if you're going to the To Be True Blue show, she will be down in Tucson. And there's a whole bunch of other fun vendors of ours and friends of ours at the To Be True Blue show. So head on down there if you're there. And Hannah then will tell us about our Let's Be Live for February.
Well, for February Let's Be Live, which is February 10th. This year from 1 to 3 p.m. Central Time. We've got Kathy King, who's going to be coming in and doing a little project and showing us how to do something called bead quilling, which is a technique that she has gone ahead and perfected. It is a technique. It's sort of related a little bit to ladder stitch, but you actually see the holes of the beads and the color of the thread becomes really important because you see the thread. It becomes, instead of something that just holds the beads together, it's going to become one of the major design techniques and design. Thank you. One of the major design components. Oh my goodness. And so she will be here on February 10th. For those of you who are members, she actually spoke to us last year about some of her large projects, but now what she's going to do is going to create a small project for us to teach us how that works and how to do it. So that's we're looking forward to that.
We are super excited. So join us in February. But today we have amazing Meredith Brody from Bead Alive.
Yay!
And so we're just so darn excited. And so Meredith, whoops, where am I? Sorry, I'm trying to do five things at one time. That's okay. Meredith has worked for Beadalon for almost 20 years in sales, product development, and marketing. She's a frequent guest on Jewel School and Jewelry Television and demonstrated and taught classes at Bead and Button, Craft and Hobby Association show, Bead Fest, Pinners, and many more. This year, she's down at the Mojo Show. And so we're so darn excited. And find her every Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern on the Beadalon Facebook Live, sharing tips and tricks, projects, and honing your jewelry making skills. Wow, that's a long name for a show, isn't it? We're so darn excited. Welcome, Meredith.
Hi, Meredith. Thank you all so much. I'm so glad to be here. This is going to be really, really fun.
Take it away. So what are we learning today, Meredith?
All right. So today we are going to do one of my favorite projects. It is, and right off the bat, apologies. I have a little bit of a cough that's been lingering. So hopefully it won't be too much of a problem through our class today. but I might have to mute myself at some point and kind of get that cough out. I'm sure everybody understands. But what we're doing today is a two needle right angle weave project. And we're going to be learning the technique, and the technique will be a bracelet. But as you can see from my necklace, same technique, different result. I've also done this technique as an earring. So the cool thing about beading, and as we know as beaders, is once you learn a technique, you can really next level it and use it for so many different applications. So just really quickly, Rochelle gave me a wonderful, wonderful introduction. My name is Meredith Roddy. I work for Beadalon and Artistic Wire. We are the company that makes the wire. We make it in our factory in Coatesville, Pennsylvania. It used to be in Westchester, but we just moved our factory out to Coatesville a couple of years ago. And we have all different kinds of pieces, parts, findings, tools. Our website is an amazing wealth of information. And as Rochelle mentioned, I also do a Facebook Live every Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern time. So that's 1 p.m. your time. Every Thursday. And we talk about new products. We talk about techniques. We answer questions. It's a wonderful, wonderful community of beaders. So hopefully if you don't join me, I send a warm invitation to do so. So I think that's about as much of an intro as I need to do. I'm going to flip my camera around and we can get right into our project. Does that sound like a good plan? All right. I'm getting nods and thumbs up. So bear with me for 1 second. I'm just in a one camera situation today. So
hi to everyone watching. Hi, Kim. Hi, Betty. Oh my gosh. We're so excited. Everybody.
Okay, super. I think I am well and set. I've got a little bit of shadowing. Like I said, I'm not in my home studio today, but I think we'll be able to do this without too much of a problem. So I will post instructions. Rochelle, what is the best place? I guess I can send them to you and you can post them in the best place.
Correct. You can, if there's a link or a PDF, you could have put it in the event. But we will, if you send it to us, we will put it on the website so that it's right next to your picture. So then they could easily download if they watch.
Okay, perfect. So what we'll need for our project today is some bead stringing wire. Oftentimes, these kinds of projects are done with thread or with Fireline or Wildfire or even a Nymo or a KO, some sort of a beading thread, because obviously I work for Beadalon. But I like making projects, especially bracelet projects, with beading wire. They are more durable. They are more long lasting. And quite frankly, I think easier to work with, because the first foundation stitch we are going to make will not need any needles. And anytime I can get away with not using needles in a project is a day that is a happy day for me. The project part two does involve a needle, but we are actually going to be using a big eye beading needle. So if you're not familiar with big eye beading needles, this might be a game changer for all of your stitching in the future. If you know big eye needles, you know why I'm using them today. Some other things that we're gonna need for our project today are a spool of your favorite beading thread. So I use Wildfire. You could use Fireline. You want to use something that's not going to stretch though. So I don't recommend using a Nymo thread or something that you have to pre-stretch for this. Wildfire or Fireline are really going to be your best bets for this project. You're going to need about 70, give or take, 6 millimeter rounds, about 25 4 millimeter rounds, about 40 3 millimeter bicones. And either a bicone or a rondel is going to be your best shape for this. What I found, and where that bead is going to go, is down here on the side. Rounds just don't work as well. I've tried rounds, and it just, you know how sometimes when you try to substitute things in for a project, sometimes substitutions are great and they work no problem, sometimes not so much. really a bicone or a rondelle is going to be your what you want for this, not a round. You are also going to need some 11 OC beads, right? We all have tons of these guys around. This is just a Mayuki. I grabbed a color that I thought would be a nice compliment. Any color will do. You will also need a clasp of your choosing. I'm choosing a toggle clasp. It's one of my favorite clasps. A lobster claw will do, really any clasp, a magnet clasp, no problem. You'll need scissors. We already talked about the big eye needle. We will need some crimp tubes. And if you have wire guardians, I always like using wire guardians. I didn't include these guys on the original parts list. So if you don't have them out in your workspace, if you're working along with me today, not to worry. But they do add just a really nice finished look to this project. Then in terms of tools, you're going to need crimping pliers, standard crimping pliers. It's normal size. You'll also need a nipper of some sort, couple pairs of chain nose pliers. And then the one thing that I forgot to bring down here with me is a thread burner or a thread zap, something like that. We at Beadalon, ours is called the Wildfire Cord Cutter, a lighter, something that you can use to trim and seal the ends of your wildfire or your fire line. Again, apologies for my cough. I really wish that it wasn't here. Okay, so a couple of different examples just to show you before we get started and dive into our project. I just have a couple of different colorways that I have worked this project in over the days and the years. This one, it was a really fun one. I really liked the way that the colors worked on this. So the middle part can actually be a rondelle. This bead can really be anything. This is a good substitution right here. Here I have a 4mm round. Here I have a 4mm rondelle. You might have to mess around with your bead counts a little bit. But again, as I mentioned in the very beginning, technique-driven project today. And once you learn this technique, so many different places that you can go with it. All right, I think I'm ready to get started. Hopefully everybody else is as well. So for my beading wire today, I'm using the Beadalon 0.015 diameter. And the reason why I'm choosing a 0.015 diameter is because as I'm going through and weaving this project, I'm going to be going through my beads a couple of different times. And I'm also going to be going through my crimp tube a couple of times. So a 0.015 beading wire is the right one for this project. A 0.018 is just going to be a little bit too thick, especially if your bead holes are a little smaller. If you have larger bead holes, the recommendation, of course, is always fill your bead holes as much as possible. And you might be able to get away with an 0.018, but then you would have to use a larger size crimp tube. There are always things to think about down the line when we're figuring out our materials, right? You have to make sure that your crimp tubes and your beading wire and everything that you're using coordinates with each other. But that's a different class for a different day. So I'm choosing an 0.015 wire and I choose 49 strand. If you had a 19 strand or a 7 strand, or even if you were using a different brand of wire that was a 21 strand, that would be okay. I just happen to almost always choose 49 strand for my beading. It's going to be the most durable and the most long lasting and the most flexible. So I'm going to pull out about 4 feet, okay? And I have my little measuring tool down here. So let's see, 4 feet. Oh, this is a strange measuring device. Looks like this is gonna be 1 foot, and I'm gonna just kind of measure against itself for 2 feet. And then 4 feet. So on the first pass, we've got a lot of beading wire here that can get a little tangly. Just be careful and make sure that your wire doesn't get tangled in on itself. I'm going to put this and that piece aside. So I have my nice long 4-foot strand of wire. And onto the strand, and I'm going to work with it doubled. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to thread on 5 size 11 seed beads. And I'm just going to bot my camera down just a gauche. See if I can get a nice tight shot here. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And then again, you don't have to use a wire guardian, but again, it makes it, your finished piece just look a little bit more fancy, I think. So next step, before I put my wire guardian on, I'm going to pick up 1 size 2 crimp tube. If you use crimp beads, a size 1 crimp bead is going to be the one that you use. And then in case you don't know what a wire guardian is, it's this little horseshoe-shaped piece of, it's just a little horseshoe-shaped finding piece of metal. It has a little tube here on one side and on the other side. And that tube is what I'm going to thread very carefully my beading wire up through around the top of that wire guardian and back down the other side. And I'm going to center this on my wire. And I was not paying the best of all possible attention. I lost my seed beads. It happens to the best of us, but no worries. We can put those back on again, no problem. So before I go back through that crimp tube, I'm going to add 1/2 of my clasp. So it doesn't matter which half you choose first. I tend to choose the bigger part of my clasp. I don't know. That's just kind of one of those random things. I always go for the bigger part. Sometimes I don't think it really matters. I don't know if anybody has a tried or true rule of thumb for which side of the clasp you add first. Then I'm going to go ahead and thread my wire back down through that crimp tube, but I'm actually not going to crimp this down. I'm just going to let it hang out. But the one thing I am going to do,
bless America.
The one thing I am going to do is I'm going to take my chain nose pliers and ever so gently bring the two ends of my wire guardian together. I see a lot of instructors skip this step, and it's not the end of the world. I just think that it looks a little bit nicer. And sometimes these ends can be a little scratchy. So I always just bring them together above the crimp tube. So it's one of those little extra somethings to make it your finished jewelry look even nicer. So since my 5 seed beads fell off the one side, I'm just going to go ahead and put them back on again. They're now on the floor of my mom's office. She is not going to be super happy about that. We'll just keep that between you and I. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I have 5 on one and 5 on the other. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick up one of those 6-millimeter rounds, only working with 6-millimeter rounds for this first one. And I'm going to put that 6-millimeter round on one of the wires. And I'm going to take the other wire and I'm going to go back through the opposite way. So I'm creating an X inside that bead, and then I'm going to pull those two ends and snug everything up. Now I don't have to worry about those beads falling off again because they're not going anywhere. Okay, so this is what everything should look like. Just looking over here on the Facebook feed to make sure I've got some things nice and in focus. I got a new phone and it's been a learning curve to figure out my focal length to make sure that you can see, I can see, we all can see. So I've got 5 seed beads on one side, 5 seed beads on the other side, 1/6 millimeter in the middle. Next step, I'm going to, and you can see I'm holding these 2 pieces of wire, one in one hand and one in the other. That's kind of the way to hold things as we go along. 1 6-millimeter bead on one side, 1 6-millimeter bead on the other side. Where's my hole? There it is. And then 1 6-millimeter bead on both of those wires crossed. So one wire comes in this way, this wire crosses the other way, but I'm not going both wires through the same direction. One is coming one way and one is coming the other way. And then I'm just going to pull nice and snug. And as you work this bracelet, now that we know the steps, as we keep going, you want your tension to be pretty tight, but not so tight that things start warping. It is naturally going to be a little bit of a looser design, and that's okay, because we are actually going to be taking several passes through this design. And each pass we take is going to shore everything up a little bit more and bring everything into line. So where something might be a little wonky or a little not quite lined up the way that you want it to be, the number of passes that you end up moving through will fix most things that might be a little out of sync. So let's go ahead and do this a couple more times. I've got 1 6-millimeter bead on one of the wires. I'm just holding this in my hand right here. 1 6-millimeter bead on the other wire. And then 1 6-millimeter bead goes on both wires. One way and one the other way. And no, it does not matter which side you put on first. I wonder if you're a lefty, if you tend to put the left side on first. If you're a righty, you tend to put the right side on first, or if there's a rhyme or a reason for doing that. I don't know. I think I tend to always start with the right side first, but it'll be interesting to see. Yeah, and then I do the second one over here. So I don't know. I think it just depends on what how your brain is feeling that day. But again, I'm not tightening this up so tight that all of these wires are hidden, because it's not possible to do. And you can see also, I'm taking my index finger and just kind of flattening it out, because the wire will generally, the tendency of the wire is to kind of bunch up on each other. You just want to remind it that you'd like it to lie flat. And then it will continue to do so. So I'm going to do just a couple more rows just to give myself a little bit more, on this piece. And then we will move on to the next step. Very, very easy design. And it really is. It's the foundation. It's the beginning of a right angle weave. But instead of doing it with just one needle and thread, we are doing it with 2 wires and creating a fabric, creating a base for all kinds of embellishment. So if you are somebody who does a lot of right angle weave, you can see where this possibly could go, right? We could add on here. We could start doing some cubic right angle weave if we want to get real fancy. We can do all different kinds of things, but a different way of thinking about it, rather than one needle, one thread, here we've got 2 wires and then crossing the wires in between. So possibilities, so many possibilities, perhaps not limitless, but lots and lots of different possibilities. So I am just going to go ahead. I think I'll do one more. And then we're going to add the second half of the class. So in the instructions, that I post, you'll see I put here for a 7-inch bracelet, you'll want about 19 center beads. Up to a 9-inch bracelet, about 23 beads in the center. Again, it's going to depend a little bit on what clasp you use, on how you like your bracelet to lay. Some people like their bracelets to be a little tighter on their wrists. Some people like their bracelets to be a little banglier, a little looser on their wrists. I was just talking on the Beadle on Facebook Live last week. I could do a whole presentation on bracelet sizing, but I feel like that at the end of the day, the takeaway message for bracelet sizing is you just kind of have to fiddle around with it until it's right. It's a terrible answer to give. But if you've made a lot of bracelets, I think that answer makes a lot of sense, is you just kind of have to fiddle around with it. And sometimes you get it perfect. And sometimes you thought that you had it perfect, and for whatever reason, something happened and it just didn't size right. There are different tips and tricks. I always like either doing an adjustable bracelet like these, or putting an extension chain on, or using memory wire, lots of different ways to kind of mitigate that bracelet sizing challenge. But yeah, that's all. Another presentation for another day. So here I've gone, and we're just going to kind of pretend that I have the right number of beads in the center. For me, I would do probably 20 beads in the center, and you should just count them out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So I'm doing a halfway bracelet for today. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to just on one of my wires. So my left wire, I'm going to let hang out over here, and onto my right wire, I'm going to pick up 5 size 11s. And keep in mind, this is a halfway bracelet. So I would have kept on going and made sure that the base was the right size for my wrist. And the great thing about this video is you can go back and watch in perpetuity on the Upper Midwest Bead Society website. So if there's something that wasn't quite as clear as it could have been, you can always go back and watch again and again. So I've got 5 seed beads. I just put on my number 2 crimp tube. I'm going to put on another wire guardian. And again, probably first thing on Monday, or maybe not first thing on Monday, but on Monday, I will send over the instructions. I just have to make a couple of changes, and we'll get those posted so you can go ahead and do the project with written instructions. I'm a written instructions kind of gal. I like seeing things on paper. It's easier for me to learn that way. So I just put the other half of my clasp on. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to string or thread that beading wire back down back down through the crimp tube. And get everything nice and tightened up. And once again, I always like to mention, I'm just going to come in here and ever so gently bring the jaws or those legs of my wire guardian together. Just think it looks nicer. It's just, and you have to do it real gentle because this is a very, very thin and malleable piece of wire. So just a gentle little squeeze to bring those legs together. And then I'm going to go ahead and put on 5 more seed beads. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so now what I'm going to do, and this is where you'll see having that 0.015 beading wire is the right choice, because this is when we're going to start going back down through our beads. And if your bead holes are too small or your beading wire is too thick, all of a sudden you're going to be really frustrated trying to do this part of the project. So I have my 5 seed beads here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back through this top bead. So you can see this wire is coming through the top bead going this way. And I'm going to add this wire coming back toward me. So I've got now in this top bead, I have, I think, three wires going through. And then this is where you just kind of, get everything nice and tightened up, take your time. And once again, I'm not crimping this crimp tube. This crimp tube is going to hang out for a little while, just like the one on this side. We'll see. Just trust, you got to trust me on this one. All right, so I got everything nice and tightened up, not too tight, but just tight enough. So now what I need to do is this wire here on the right and this wire here on the left need to come through the next beads right here. So let's do this one first. Got my wire on the right, and I'm going to thread it through just one of these beads. And it's going to maybe want to go through the next bead. Just take it nice and slow, bring it through. And I'm going to do the same thing on this side with this wire. And of course, if your bracelet, if you've gone all the way down, so your bracelet is long enough, these wires will be a little bit shorter and a little bit easier to manage. So I'm just going to grab that and pull that down. And it needs to be just a little bit tighter. I don't need so much wire sewing, and I want to make sure everything is nice and symmetrical, not pulled too much on one side or the other side. Okay. So now I'm just going to set my wire on the left to one side. And now this is where we're going to grab the 3 millimeter. These are 3 millimeter bicombs. These are, some Chinese crystal. You could use Swarovski. You could use, you could use 3 millimeter rondelles. Rounds are not gonna be great because of where the beads need to nestle against this wire here. It's just kind of one of those things that I found out by trial and error. Picking up a 3 millimeter bicone, and then I'm going to go through the next bead in the row. So sometimes this can be a little persnickety to get that wire through that bead, but just pull it through and tighten it up. And you can see where those beads and the wire, how they sit nicely. And this is a great project that is a candidate for using colored wire. You were mentioning that one of the classes coming up is on bead quilling, which is actually next on my list of techniques that I want to learn. I just kind of came across that, and it looks so cool. And I love that it is a technique where the stringing material really can take center stage. That's one of the things that we talk about at Beadalon a lot, is the stringing material and how that can become part of the design. So bead quilling is right up my alley, where you're really using the color of your thread as a design element. I'm excited that you guys are doing that as a beading class coming up. So also you can see I'm using the regular bright wire here, but on this project, I used satin gold wire. So the gold wire becomes a part of the design. And on this one, there's one here. And on this one, I'm using satin silver wire. So the wire color and your stringing material color really can have a big impact on your finished design. At Beadalon, we tend to do a lot of designing where the wire is the star of the design. So it's always top of mind for me what color my stringing materials are going to be. And I know that a lot of seed beaters
The goal is to make the thread disappear into the work, right? You don't want to see the thread when you're doing a you know, a right angle weave or a herringbone stitch or a peyote or even loom work. But for us, we like to highlight the stringing materials. All right, so I'm down here. I've come to my last one. And now I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to do the same thing on the other side. So very simple. And I like this project because, again, once you learn the technique, it's very repetitive. It's very meditative. And then just with a couple of extra little tweaks here and there, you can really make a fantastic design. The necklace that I'm wearing, and I'll show that in just a second, is another variation, or I'll show it at the end, because you don't necessarily have to just use 6 millimeter beads here as our base, right? You can vary all different kinds of sizes, and then things start bending and curving and turning into circles and all kinds of really fun design possibilities. So, just going to keep on going, just a couple more. And then we'll see why at the ends we left those crimp tubes and we left them uncrimped. It also gives you the opportunity to keep going, right? We don't have to just stop with this as an embellishment. There are all kinds of things that we can keep doing, right? We can come back around here with seed beads. We could come back around here with different sizes of seed beads. Lots and lots of different possibilities. However, for today and today's classes, we have to make some design decisions, right? And so the design decision today is to do one layer of beads on top. But before we do that, we need to finish this off, right? So the goal is these two wires need to both go through this crimp tube. Another reason why I really like using beading wire for this project, and why I really like using beading wire in general for these, I'm just gonna bop this up real quick, give myself a little bit more room, is I like crimping. I think crimping is the single strongest way to finish off your beaded jewelry. And if you crimp correctly with a little bit of practice, you can really up the ante for how strong and secure your jewelry is. It's just a little funky here. What I'm doing is I'm bringing that wire through all five of those seed beads, and I also have to get it through that crimp tube. Okay, so we're just gonna take our time and make that happen. So this is one of those, bear with me as the instructor. Sometimes you can do some magic and things can happen faster, and other times not as fast. So I just kind of have to take my time and get this through. And it will go, just have to be patient. I can feel it. You know how you can feel things happening. Hold that down. Come on. Come on, friend. All right. Let's go to plan B. I'm going to try to pull that wire out before the crimp. And I don't know if this is a true for you all, but I like watching designers struggle through challenges and figure out, okay, I know what I want to do here, right? I know what I want to make happen, and I know that I can make it happen. how are we going to make that happen together, right? So
well, it makes us all feel more like we're in it together, and you know,
exactly. Exactly. I used to get so like flustered and frustrated and like, oh my gosh, I have to do it absolutely perfectly the first time. But that's not how beading works, right? And it's good, like you were saying, Rochelle, you know, we all have these struggles. So how can we figure out how to fix the problems together? So I got it through 4 of the beads. So now I just have 2 more to go. This is when it's good to be doing your beading while you're watching a nice show or having a bead along with some friends. Rochelle, you want to tell us a story while I struggle to get this through?
Well, for those of you who have never experienced 20 below zero, that's where our wind chills are right now. And so we're headed for 40 below zero tomorrow. So today's the warm day. We're so excited that you're home and warm and cozy with us and instead of out in the cold. But other than that, we really, thanks for joining us. Oh my gosh. I'm using wood beads today for mine. I don't know, what is everybody else using? Feel free to unmute and talk to us. Don't be shy.
Well, I have a little bit to say. So first of all, Terry Schroeder says hello to everybody. She is on Facebook watching. And
hi, Terry.
Second is that Rochelle is going to be hosting something special with the Japan Toho folks on Thursday. What is it? Thursday the
18th. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
So why don't you talk about that for a second?
Well, those of you who are familiar with the Toho Challenge, it's the end of 2023. So we want to show off the designs to everyone, and all the featured designers' designs right now are in the Gallery T in Tokyo, in Japan. And so on Thursday night, we'll be having a live gallery tour. Thursday, 6 p.m. Central Time is 9 a.m. Japan time the next day. So they will be taking you on a tour of all the featured designs throughout the gallery in Japan there and talking about them. And then you'll be able to have a live interview with one of our members, Sandra Rothers, and then Kimi Suto. And we're just so darn excited. They will be live from Japan, and we'll be having our first sneak peek of the 2024 challenge. So if you're excited to get started, this would be your first look at the very end of the show. You have to stick around and you'll be able to see the new colors and the new theme.
Did you say 6:30, Rochelle?
6 p.m. Central Time on Thursday night. And that will be on the Team Toho Facebook page.
Perfect. So thank you for killing some time for me. I did get that one finally through the crimp tube. I'm not going to make us wait for me to get the second one through. Can be done, but I think when I rewrite the instructions, we're going to go with 5/8 seed beads here. That'll solve that problem right away. So it'll be a little less delicate here on the ends, but a lot easier to get those beads through or get that wire through and through the ends. Sure, we can do it with the 11s, but do we want the challenge? If you want the challenge, stick with 11s. If not, let's bump it up to 8s. We don't need to make ourselves crazy for this project. So once you have that done, you can actually go ahead and crimp the top and the bottom. And just a real quick crimping lesson here. These are the crimping pliers, for those who are unfamiliar. There are 2 notches in crimping pliers. The front notch is a smooth oval. The back notch has a little dimple in it. Crimping is a 3-step process. You come and you go in the front jaw and gently press down. Come to the back jaw, then gently press down. And then back to the front jaw, where you very carefully, because we've got seed beads here, but you want to press down with the crimp tube perpendicular in the jaw of the crimpers and then round it around and around and around and around. Do not smush your crimp. Do not do anything that I did not just demonstrate. The crimps are calibrated to work with the wire and with the tool. And if you follow those three steps and practice, 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 you will have perfect crimps all the time. So last step in our process, is this the right one? Nope, here it is, sorry. So last step in the process, we're gonna take that wildfire or fire line or whatever it is that you like for your stringing material. I like to use a one that's not going to stretch, and wildfire and fire line are a good one. And just tie a little knot here. I just have this tied to the wire. Nothing fancy, just an overhand, or I'm sorry, a surgeon's knot. And then I sealed the end with a cord cutter. And this is where my big eye beading needles are really going to be the star of the show. If you don't know what a big eye beading needle is, it is a needle where the eye of the needle spans the whole middle section of the needle. So you can see here how big that space is to be able to thread your needle. No more, nothing, right? Uh-oh. Did you see how easy that was for me to thread the needle? These are great as my eyes get a little bit older and the light perhaps is a little bit more challenging to work with. I find myself reaching for big eye beading needles all the time. So if it's not something that you have experienced before, I definitely recommend checking big eye beading needles out. Okay, so I have my thread secured, and I'm going to string through that top bead. And you can see, again, we're going through these beads several times. So again, that's why our 0.015 beading wire and our beads, and you want to make sure they have nice large holes, is where you want to be for this project. All right, last step. We're going to pick up 4 size 11 seed beads, 1 4-millimeter round, 4 size 11 seed beads. Easy enough. Let's go ahead and do that. 1, 2, 3, 4 seed beads. 1 4-millimeter round. And 4, 1, 2, 3, 4 size 11 seed beads. So this is the part that it's a little, you just have to watch where your thread path is. So I'm coming out of this top bead and my thread is on the right. I'm going to go back through the next bead in the center, but I'm going to go back through from left to right. Okay. So it's just, sometimes I get a little tripped up on that. So just be aware, and you want to make sure that you're only going through that center bead and that your needle is going to come out above that side bead here. It will want to go someplace else. Sometimes it wants to poke down, sometimes it wants to poke other places. You just want to take care and make sure that it's coming out right above. And my thread here got tangled. So you also want to make sure that your thread doesn't get tangled. So here we go. That is my first part of my last pass. So once again, I'm gonna repeat that step. Really easy project, 3 different parts with the steps just repeating over and over again. So 1 size or 4-millimeter round, 4 more. And once again, My thread is coming out of this right-hand side. So I'm going to go through the next bead from left to right. And let's see if my thread, if I can get my needle to kind of misbehave this time and see what happens. Just got to get it pushed through. And again, I've got a lot going on. Here we go. Okay, my needle is misbehaving. It's coming down behind, okay? I'm still going to pull it through. I just need to be aware that that is where my needle is coming out of. And I just want to reposition that needle so that it's back on top. Okay, so it's okay if your needle is a little bit misbehaving and it goes where it wants to go. Just make sure that for your next thread path, the next one that you do, you just want to make sure that your needle is in the right place. So let's just do one, or let's just do maybe a couple more. One, two, three, four. And 1 4-millimeter here. And 1, 2, 3, 4. And my thread is coming out over here. And I know that I want to go from left to right on the next bead down. And let's see if maybe I can get my needle to behave this time. Let's see, where does it even want to come out? Yep. Again, it for whatever reason, the needle oftentimes will want to come in the back. And that's okay. I think it's a win just to get that needle through. And sometimes things get a little funky where we know how that works, but we just want to make sure that each time we add our beads and we go through that next bead, that the wire or the thread is coming out on top of this side. And then we just continue that thread path down and down and down, all the way down to the next side, or to the bottom, I should say. And same thing as we did on the beginning, because it's wildfire. Just going to tie a little overhand knot, a little, probably a double overhand knot, and then use your cord, your thread burner or your cord cutter to trim and seal the ends. And then you have so many different possibilities for finishing out this design. I'm going to pull out before I turn the camera back around, I'm going to take off the necklace that I have on, which is the exact same technique. But since I used 8-millimeter beads on the outside and then 6-millimeter beads here on the inside, it curves. So it curves like a necklace, and is much more comfortable to wear. I've also done this technique as, I'll just put that to the side, as earrings. I'm actually doing these earrings as part of our Tucson show for our Make It and Take It. Exact same technique, but instead of varying the beads on the side, I did 8-millimeter, 6-millimeter, 4-millimeter. So same exact technique, really, really fun earrings. So once you have it mastered, once you get that 2-needle right angle weave, and you start building up different patterns, you can really, really find some fabulous designs. And even as I have them here next to each other, you can see if you keep going, if you're a right angle weave aficionado, make it longer. Just so many different possibilities. But with that, I think if I didn't see any questions and there were no interruptions, was there anything that I missed, guys?
Well, my question is, can you do a crisscross? You've got from a dangle to a dangle, you know, from diagonal. Could you do a second overlay with the seed bead and then join through your focal bead and then come
absolutely. From the side? Yep. So 100%. I think, Rochelle, in all honesty, I like the way that it looks like this.
In the asymmetrical, uh-huh.
Yeah, it's just totally to my design eye. But all you would need to do is come back through with the 1, 2, 3, 4, and then come back through this. Do you go back mm-hmm. through? I think you go back through this way, yeah.
Yeah, I know the bead shifts direction a little bit. So that a little bit maybe turns it into more of an X versus
maybe. But I've played around with it. It's just for my mind's eye. It's just I don't like it as much, but I know that a lot of people do. You just go back through this bead the opposite way. And then you just pull it. So you would go all the way down. And then all the way back. And you can either have this bead go this way, or you could do it like this, where you would do 1, 2, 3, 4, and then go back through vertical up and down.
Right. And then the bead would change that direction more or stay more that direction.
And so 1, 2, 3, 4. And again, that's why I love this design so much, because there's so many different possibilities for taking it to the next level.
I love the size differential from a 6 to an 8 on one side, so that you could get that curve to go automatically.
Yep. And I made one just as a base that I have here. It's not finished, but here I use those 8s as the foundation. So you can make it, you know, even chunkier and just kind of, you know, play around with the math of it all with the 6s and the 4s and the 8s and, you know, even go up to 10s and 12s, you know. Sky's the limit.
Or go down in size to 4s and 2s, you know, and make it micro.
That is bold. I like your style.
We have a question about how long those earrings are that you showed.
Earrings, that is a good question. These earrings are, where did my measuring device go? I love that when you're teaching classes and things were literally right in front of you, and then when you go to look for them again, they are not there. Oh, here it is. So these are about 2 inches, 1.5 inches.
Super, thank you.
When you were talking about your pattern, for like 19 beads down the center beads makes a 7-inch bracelet. You were talking about the length prior to, without the clasp. Is that the length?
That is a good question. That's a very good question. I think when I did this particular project and these instructions, I think that it was taking into account the particular clasp that I was using for this project, which was a small toggle clasp. I will double check that on when I post these and be clearer on that. That's a really good question though.
Thank you.
Anything else? I'm gonna flip my camera around real quick.
Can you hear me?
I can.
Okay, I have a question. If you're teaching this pattern and it's just going to be out there, can I teach it to other people if I give you credit?
Yeah, for all of the bead-along patterns, anything that I teach or that is posted on our website, we do it so that you can teach it as well. We love when you give bead-along credit, it's the right thing to do. But yes, certainly feel free to use this pattern, sell things from this pattern, pass it forward, pay it forward.
Yeah, this is super fun. I think it's a really easy way to introduce people into right angle weave who are very afraid of it.
Yeah, thank you. That's what I was thinking.
I have been afraid of right angle weave and cubic right angle weave and all of the right angle weaves for years and years and years. And it's legitimate. I am very appreciative of people who are a little taken aback by right angle weave. It's not for the meek, but with a little perseverance, you can, and the right tutorial. That's what I really needed to find, is someone who could break it down in a way that my brain worked. So I definitely encourage people, really for any bead work, if there's something that you want to learn, as complicated or as easy as it is, and the first tutorial that you watch or that you read or that you are experiencing doesn't make it click for you, keep going, because there are so many amazing instructors out there, and each of them teaches something a little bit differently. And at some point, it's going to click. It might take, in my case, for cubic right angle weave, for example, years. But finally, Kelly Dale from Off the Beaded Path, like, she broke it down in a way that I was like, now I understand. Now I can do this.
Mm-hmm. Well, it makes total sense. And I do like the way that it is so versatile. You could use any size, you know, round bead, whether it's glass, wood, stone. I mean, that's, you know, the easy part is.
Did anybody make a long today? Can I see what you did?
Here, let me focus you, Shelly. Hold on. Let's add a spotlight. Let's see. There you go. That's beautiful. You are a beauty.
Fantastic. That's wonderful.
I like that very well. That's cool.
Good job.
Yay. And so then let me unmute your unremove. Okay. So then let's see, gallery. Who else has one? Okay. So Marlene, wait a minute. Let me spotlight you. There you go, Marlene.
Pretty.
Ooh, pretty.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I like it. You are a fast beater. I'm very impressed.
You really
are. I have the same colors as Marlene, but opposite. I started with silver pearls and I'm using aqua.
Okay, let me get your spotlight. Wait a minute, show it again, Becky. I'm a little slow on my spotlighting, so let's do it again. Ooh, I like the pearls. That's really nice.
Yeah, and then I'll have aqua accents on it.
Nice, I love it. And so let's see, gallery. Okay, who else wants to show their work? Anybody? Fine, then I will show mine. And so I haven't gotten to the second level yet, but I did wood beads with crystals in the middle. They're rosewood. And so I'm getting to my second layer, but I was doing the whole bracelet, so I was moving a little slower. Golly gee, you guys are fast. And I could not get it through my 11 O's at the end. And instead of taking it all apart, I just made a second layer of 11 O's and went through the crimp again because I couldn't get through my 11 O's.
That's a great idea.
So I love that, Rochelle. It's a single layer because you fold it in half, but the other layer, it's a double layer, just a double. And so, but it goes through the crimp. It just wouldn't go through my 11. So I'm like, should I take it apart, redo it? And I'm like, no, let me just work it.
It's a little, it went, but I'm going to change my my instructions. I'm going to do eights there just to make people's lives easier when they are figuring it out for the first time. And then once you've got it, then you can go ahead and do the challenge round.
Right. And if you're using, because I used the Softflex Fine, which is a 0.014. And yeah, it would go through a couple of my 11s, but not all of them. So I didn't, you know, so but that was a good second way. And it doesn't look bad, you know? I mean, it's just another row. What the heck?
Yep, and that's what we do as beaters. We problem solve.
Right.
So maybe it didn't work out the way that we had initially anticipated, or you were using Toho beads, I was using Mayuki beads. So maybe that had
Well, I haven't got to the bead part yet. These were just the rounds, and so I haven't done the top part yet.
Gotcha.
I'm getting there, but yes, I will use Toho beads, and I want to see how the Edo demis work and, you know, things like that. And you never know. I mean,
oh, I think the Edo demis would be so pretty.
Wouldn't it?
Yes, I love it. Yep. So again, that's really what I wanted to do today is to teach a project that was really more of a technique, so that once you get it with that base and that overlay, a million different possibilities.
Yeah. So what is your upcoming Thursday? We have our new Thursday coming next week. So what are you, can we have a sneak peek or a
Absolutely.
Little...
So this Thursday, Wyatt White will be joining me for our Facebook Live, and he and I are going to be talking about, it's a really cool tool that we have in the Beadalon, catalog. It is a interchangeable nylon jaw plier, so that head of the plier is interchangeable with it's three different sizes of rounds, or three different sizes of squares, or three different sizes of ovals.
Wow.
And it was new as of last year. So a year old is still a pretty new tool in the Beadalon world. And so, excuse me. So we're going to talk about using the tool. We're going to talk about changing out the heads. We're going to do some projects. And it's always a hoot when Wyatt and I are on the Facebook Live together. We bicker like siblings. So yeah. It's always, you definitely want to tune in for an entertaining hour.
Absolutely. Oh my gosh. Well, I mean, yeah, put you two together and that's just a riot.
You never know what's going to happen.
It's just you two. Yeah. I mean, and so it's so fun. And so I really, because you don't need then three tools. You can use one tool and change out the heads.
Yep. Interchangeable nylon head plier, I believe, is the official name of it.
That's exciting. We always love a new tool, or at least I do. Especially for the wire wrappers. And so, does anybody else have any questions or want to show us their thing? I know you've been badly beating. I see you all in the background. We're so happy you guys joined us on Facebook. And we've got so many people joining us. Hi. Oh my gosh. Thank you. And so they just love it. They thought it was really fun. Sending love and fellowship. And then we have somebody else who says they bought the tool when it came out and like it.
Oh, good. Good, good, good. Well, definitely check out 2 p.m. Eastern time on Thursday.
It's on the Beadalon Instagram, right?
It's the Beadalon Facebook page, and it'll be fun for me because it's not a tool that I use very often. And so it's going to kind of be Wyatt teaching me how to use the tool. And it'll be neat to kind of see what the possibility is, because we look at things and we think about things in such a different way. And so I love when he shows me his tips and techniques, and then I kind of put them through the Meredith filter and then figure out how I'm going to use them.
I love it. Because he's more of a wire wrapper base experience, right?
Correct. Yep. He is the wire wrapper. And I've got some skills, but I think it's helpful for him to teach me because I'm not at that level. And so sometimes it's easier for me to translate that into a beginner vernacular, because I'm learning a lot of the things as I go along as well.
Absolutely. I mean, I've learned several things just from this bracelet today. So
learn today, Rochelle?
Well, just trying to get partly the tension right. And I normally don't weave with my Softflex wire line or the Beadalon wire. as much as I used to do it years ago, but then, you know, Fireline comes out and all the 1G and I switch to thread and I forget about, you know, that it is super flexible. It feels great. And you can, like you said, use the bigger beads, the heavier weight beads that you could never use a normal Fireline through an 8mm stone. No way and how, you know, and this is like, even if you didn't want to do the second layer, if you just wanted to do the first layer, you know, I think that that is a really, you know, modern classic. You could take that, you know, feminine, masculine, you could just do anything with it, you know. And
I have a question. Is it possible to look at your Thursday presentation at a different time? I will be at my book club.
Yeah, the BLM Facebook Lives are on the Facebook page in perpetuity. So you can go back and watch. I don't know why you would want to, but 6 years or 8 years, I don't know how long. We've been doing this for a very long time. So if there was, you know, if you're like, oh, I wonder what Meredith has to say about stretch bracelets, you can always go back and search and see the past ones that we've done. But you know, over on Beadalon Facebook page, you just go to Facebook and then search up the Beadalon and my face comes up.
Thank you.
Yay. And if you don't have the crimping tool, there's all kinds of places to get it. There's a couple of people that said they don't have it. Bobby Bead does have them. Lotus Beads has them if you're local in Minneapolis. Otherwise, they're online, both platforms. And there's many other, if you Google Beadalon crimping tool, there are different sizes. And Meredith, do you want to tell us about just the different sizes really quick so that they get the right size tool for the right size crimp?
Yep. So condensed version of an hour-long presentation. Beadalon bead stringing wire. We've got diameter, size crimp tube. There is a corresponding chart on our website and on the tool. I believe it's on the tool packaging, but there's three different sizes of crimp pliers. 90% of the time, you're going to need the standard crimping pliers. That's what I would recommend. If you're going to buy your first pair of crimping pliers, you want JT Crimp 1. Very good, Marlene. That's awesome. JT Crimp 1, standard size. There are small crimp tubes, size 1 or size 0 crimp beads that you would use a micro crimper for. And there are larger crimp tubes, size 4 crimp tube or size 3 crimp bead that you would use a mighty crimper for. Incidentally, mighty crimpers are also really good for closing crimp covers and rounding out different wire accoutrements. But takeaway message, standard crimping plier, the part number is JT Crimp 1. That's what you're going to use for almost all of your stringing needs, unless you're doing something really, really fine or much bigger, or if you're doing, say, you know, 4 strands through a large crimp tube. But starting out, standard crimping plier is the way to go.
Super. Thank you so much, because if you don't get that crimp right, it just is going to pull right out. And so.
And people get really frustrated with crimping, I've noticed over the years. And it is a skill. It's not just as simple as boom, boom, and you're done. And I try to really drive that point home when I'm teaching crimping. It's part of the skill. You wouldn't just, you know, make a wire wrapped loop and call it a day, or you wouldn't just do, you know, a peyote star just kind of haphazardly. It's really the foundation of keeping your design together. So you want to make sure that you're putting it in the front and making it into a little oval, and putting it in the back and making it into a crescent shape, and then back in the front, and really go around and take your time rather than just boom, 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 and then hope that it's going to hold.
And then isn't it important too about how your wire is laying inside there too?
Yeah, and you want to make sure that your wires aren't crossed in the crimp. Oftentimes, if your wire is breaking at the crimp, we take our wire very seriously at Beadalon. We manufacture it, so it's our baby. We're making the wire, and if you have that wire crossed in your crimp and then you smush it, you're actually breaking and putting more tension than necessary or wanted on those wires. And when you have the friction of wearing a piece of jewelry, or if you're really rough on your jewelry, or if you have a child or a grandchild pulling and tugging on that jewelry, it's only as good as that join is, or as that crimp is. And so if you are already breaking wires inside that crimp by having them smushed against each other, they're already at a disadvantage. You want to make sure that when your wires go through the crimp, and it can be a little challenging because they want to cross. They really do. You just have to remind those wires that they need to sit next to each other like good little soldiers, so that one's in one side of that crimp and one's in the other side of that crimp.
Thank you so much. I mean, all those tips and tricks are just a little thing can really make or break your bracelet, right?
Yep, literally. Yeah, make or break your bracelet, 100%.
This is just so cool. And so when you go down to Tucson coming up, that is a big trip with a wonderful show. I know it's a wholesale show, but you're showing off new products or new things or...
Yeah, so do you want the...
Yeah, what are you doing? Tell us a little bit about, you know.
So... what Beadalon does in Tucson, we do our own show. It's called the Mojo Show, and it is a wholesale only show. But we do have many of our vendors throughout the town of Tucson who do have Beadalon products for cash and carry. But since we are the manufacturer, we partner together with Dreamtime Creations, Leather Cord USA, Impress Art, and Caravan Beads, and then Beadalon, to do our own smaller wholesale only show. And like you were saying, Rochelle, we show all of our new products, and it's really a collaboration of all of the companies coming together and showing how all of our products work together. We have an earring bar that we set up for Make It Take It's in the middle of the room, and then it's really more of kind of a party fun atmosphere rather than a come and shop at a bead show. But we have two categories of two pretty significant things that we're debuting in Tucson this year. So one of the things that Beadalon really took a stand on this year is taking the phthalates out of all of, and the vinyl out of all of our tool handles. So these are old handles here. I don't have a new set with me. But one of the things that doesn't get talked about a lot is the bad stuff, for lack of a better word, that is in many of the plastics and many of the dipped handled tools. So Beadalon went out and we said, we're not doing that anymore. All of our tools are vinyl free. And so we've redone our entire line of tools. I think we have 40 new handles. And that's what I'm carrying with me to Tucson, 40 tools. and so that's our first story. The second story is that Beadalon has not until the last couple of weeks had Fireline in our product mix. We carry Dandelion, we have Supplemax, we have Wildfire as our kind of premier stringing material. And I love Wildfire. I helped develop it when I came to the company 17 years ago. But a lot of bead weavers, myself included, really like using Fireline for our weaving. It's what most instructors historically have taught. And so when people have learned how to do seed bead weaving, whether it's dimensional or bracelets or whatever it is, Fireline oftentimes is what people are looking for. And at Beadalon, we haven't had the opportunity to distribute it until now. And so that's a really, really big deal for us. And it's a big deal for me because I love playing with seed beads. And it gives me the opportunity to tell that story. So those are really the two big categories of things that we're going to be showing as Beadalon at our show, is the tools and the fire line. You muted yourself somehow.
I have noise in my house, but to be eco-friendly as a company and to be more sustainable is really important. And so that's really nice to hear that you're leading the industry, and it's things we never even think about.
Yeah.
I have a question. Did somebody pick up making Fireline?
Because Fireline never has been stopped. I'm sorry, I interrupted. I apologize.
No, that's okay. You're correct. It is still being manufactured by Berkeley. There was a lot of misinformation about that company, about the manufacturing, about the different distributors who carry it. And I don't feel kind of comfortable, you know, saying one way or the other, because I don't know the full story. But I do know that it is, the company is Berkeley. They've always been and always have been and still are manufacturing the Fireline. Through COVID, there were a lot of problems. We had challenges getting Wildfire to market. We had challenges getting Beetle and Beadstringing Wire to market. There was just so many problems with the supply chain and problems with factories and things happening behind the scenes, things happening in front of the scenes. But I didn't chime in, but I have read a lot of the comments in, you know, groups like Seed Beads and More and different places on the internet where people chime in. And sometimes the information is correct, and sometimes the information is as correct as people know at that moment. But bottom line, Berkeley still makes it.
Okay. Because I know, we live in fishing country here, and I know that a lot of the fishing stores are no longer carrying it. Because that's where I've always bought it.
You can buy it right from their website. Go to berkeley.com and there it is, right there. Okay. Yeah.
I don't think I'm going to need
it. Yeah, a lot of that has to do with different distributorships and different companies within the fishing industry changing their purchasing habits and their, you know, people have price increases and there's all different kinds of stuff that goes into those decisions.
Who wants to pay for the shelf space?
Yeah. Yep, for sure. But I think of things in terms of diameter, and Fireline thinks of things in terms of pound strength. So I'm still making that brain shift. But we have the double, so 0.005, 006, 007, and 010, I think, diameters. I apologize, I don't have the specifics in front of me right now. But we have four different diameters, a bunch of different put-ups. And the day that I actually saw the Beadalon logo and the Berkeley logo on the spool together when they came in, I got a little tear in my eyes. So we're really excited about it.
Very, very good to hear on many, many fronts all over that there's no supply interruptions, you know, with all of our favorite products.
Yeah, we actually also, for the Seed Bead Weavers, just introduced back in November, Wildfire Ultra. So one of the challenges that we had with Wildfire is because of the way that it's coated, it's always been just a little bit thicker than that 006 diameter. And when you're doing real fine seed bead weaving, you know, any geometric beadwork, going back through your beads more than twice, or if you're using 15s, the Wildfire can be a little thick. But this Wildfire Ultra is a true 0.004 diameter. It is unbelievably thin and very, very thread-like. So whereas Fireline tends to be a little more fishing liney, The Wildfire Ultra really feels more like a Nymo or a KO or a Toho, a 1G kind of thread. It doesn't have that kind of spring that the 1G has. It's truly, truly non-stretch. But again, you know, as seed bead weavers, we know, or as beaders, there's always the right material for the job. And depending on what beads you're using and what stitch you're doing and what you're creating is going to inform, do you use, do you use Wildfire? Do you use Fireland? Do you use beading wire? Could you consider using something else? Maybe like we did today, something that Rochelle, you were saying you'd always use Fireline for in the past. Well, beading wire makes a really interesting option for constructing that kind of design.
Yeah, absolutely.
I like how it feels.
You like how it feels?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a different spring for the, I'm sorry, I took mine apart, so I started over. But I didn't cut a long enough piece of stuff, so I was stuck.
And gotcha. Yeah, that's the one thing you want to make sure that you start with at least 4 feet of beading wire, because you can't really add.
Exactly.
That's the one challenge of working with beading wire over using a thread, is it's tough, much tougher to add thread or to add cord or to add beading wire than it is to add cord. Everything has its trade-offs.
Well, I looked at trying to add the beads with just Fireline, and it wasn't working, so I just took it all apart and
gotcha.
Started over.
It's nice. It's so fast and easy that, you know, you could make several in a day easily. And so that instant gratification, Jean and all of us that we need, it really fits the ticket. So many of our projects take so many hours long and days that to be able to finish a couple in one day is really nice.
Yeah, I have a lot of very long-term beading projects and then shorter things that I can finish and feel real good about.
Yep.
Yeah, I have things I've been working on for 20 years. I'm sure we all have.
Absolutely.
I think I have a knitting project like that.
This is so fun. Thank you so much. Any other comments, questions for Meredith, anyone? We reading more of the very, very pretty.
No, thank you so much. That was great.
Everybody, it was really my pleasure. It's one of my favorite projects to teach, and I really appreciate everyone's attention and interest and comments and questions. This has been wonderful, and I'm happy to do it again.
Oh my God. Thank you so much for everything. And we really hope that everybody joining us, thank you for beading with us. We look forward to seeing you again. Become a member of the Upper Midwest Bead Society. It's only $35 a year, and we have 2 events per month. And invite your friends, because the Saturday one is free for everyone. And then always check out our YouTube channel as well if you missed, and share the love. Happy beading, everyone. And check out February 10th for our quilling class. And then on the Monday, the 12th, for Betty Cox. So go to umbs.org for all of your information. And thank you so much for joining us today. Happy beading, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.